Hello, this is Gerard from Creative PowerPoint. Today, we'll learn to make 3D objects like this chessboard moving on a 3D board using PowerPoint only. But before we do so, we need to understand the basics of 3D modeling in PowerPoint.
We will cover the creation of 3D objects, the difference between isometric and perspective rendering, the creation and resizing of a sphere, movement in 3D space, and the relation with PowerPoint layers.
Join me in this tutorial, and in no time, you'll become an expert of 3D in PowerPoint.
Let's create our first 3D object in PowerPoint. To create a 3D object in PowerPoint, we first create a 2D shape and add some depth to it, an operation called extrusion. Let's create a rounded rectangle and open the Format Shape panel. In the Effects tab, we can see the 3D format and 3D rotation sections that will allow us to do our 3D operations. Let's start by rotating the object in 3D space by changing the X, Y, or Z rotation options. At the time I'm recording, the Mac version of PowerPoint has a bug and doesn't display the rotation values. There's also right now a bug with the Y rotation icon. The second icon is showing the wrong rotation direction. Just keep this in mind until Microsoft fixes the icon. Now, let's extrude our object. We do so by going to the depth parameter and adding a positive depth value. We can also add a bevel at the front and at the back of the shape. We'll explore this topic in more details in a moment. We can also add a text to the shape. When you're editing the text, the shape goes back to its initial 2D shape, but after you exit edit mode, the shape is redisplayed in 3D. I'd like to mention that by default, PowerPoint displays 3D objects using what we call an isometric representation. One characteristic of isometric 3D is that objects far away appear to be the same size as objects that are close to the viewer. Also, parallel lines stay parallel. PowerPoint allows you to switch to a perspective mode and display objects as you can see on the right-hand side. Perspective 3D is more realistic, as objects in the distance appear smaller as objects that are close to us. We are not going to cover this representation in this video. Let's see how to create a sphere in PowerPoint. To build a sphere, we start by creating a 2D circle and extruding it. To ensure we are creating a circle and not an oval, hold the Shift key while you're creating the circle. To extrude the circle into a sphere, we will create circle bevels at the front and at the back. Let's start with the front bevel. Click on top bevel and select the first option, the circle bevel. We don't have a sphere yet because we still need to adjust the width and the height of the bevel. Now, looking at the shape format tab, we can notice that our circle has a diameter of 10 cm. Just calculate the radius of the circle, which is half of that value, so 5 cm. Then use the radius for both the width and the height of the bevel. Type the radius and make sure you also type the unit after the value. So don't just type 5, because PowerPoint will interpret it as being 5 points. But type 5 cm if you're on the metric system, or 5 in if you're in the US. Once we've done that, we can rotate our object, and we can see that only the front has this spherical shape. This is because we haven't added a bottom bevel yet. Let's do the same operation for the bottom bevel. We now have a sphere, but we have this ugly line at the boundary between the two semi-spheres. This is an artifact caused by the shape outline. To remove it, just go to the Fill and Line tab and remove the line. One last thing, you may notice that the sphere tends to move around when you rotate it. This is because it is now misaligned with what PowerPoint considers to be the ground. I'll explain in more details how this works in a moment, but to fix this, you can simply go to the Distance from Ground text box and enter the sphere radius, not forgetting the unit. So in our case, 5 cm. And after you've done that, the object now rotates around its center. If you're trying to resize a sphere, you may notice this weird behavior where the sphere either takes a pill or a rugby ball shape. This is because resizing changes the circle radius, and so the radius we initially entered is no longer correct. So, whenever you resize a sphere, don't forget to readjust the bevel's width and height. And don't forget to readjust the distance from ground as well. If you really want to freeze the sphere, you can always copy and paste it as an image, but keep in mind that you lose the ability to further rotate the object. And you might also observe some loss in image quality. We now need to understand how objects are positioned in 3D space, and particularly the relation between the object and what PowerPoint calls the ground. I've created an orange circle and rotated it with three different angles. The left part of the slide shows the circle without any rotation applied. This is exactly what you see after you have created a circle on a PowerPoint slide. By default, PowerPoint shows you objects from the point of view of an observer that is sitting above the ground and is looking down. I picture the feet of that person at the bottom left. If you look at the middle picture, this is what a second person could observe. At the top, the observer, who's looking at the PowerPoint slide and laid flat on the ground, is this circle. The third column shows this circle from a different angle. Let's add a depth of 50 points to understand how this impacts the position in space of the object. As you can see in the middle picture, PowerPoint has added the object's depth behind the object. And if we want the object to be sitting on the ground again, we need to compensate for this. Let's set the depth value, so 50 points, as a distance from the ground. And you can see that PowerPoint has heightened the object, and it's now sitting on the ground again. Now, let's add a 30 points bevel. We can see that the bevel has pushed the object depth even further below. To compensate for this, let's increase the object distance from ground. Let's add the value of the bevel and of the depth, so 50 plus 30 equals 80, and use it as a distance from ground value. Finally, let's add a bottom bevel with a height of 80 to create this mooring post shape. Again, the bevel has been added to the back of the object, and if we want to compensate, we need to increase the distance from ground by the value of the bottom bevel. Let's set the distance from ground as 50 plus 30 plus 80, so 160 points in our case. And our mooring post is now sitting on the ground. The last fundamental point I'd like to address is how multiple objects overlay each other. In our slide, we now have two 3D shapes or mooring post and some sort of a rainbowy explosion. How does PowerPoint handle that? Look at the middle picture. PowerPoint really renders every object separately on its respective layer. Then it will overlay all rendered objects in layer order. Due to the way this is computed, we have this strange rendering discrepancy between different angles. On the left-hand side, without any rotation, the explosion appears to be above the post, but is shown next to the post when we've applied some rotation, like in the right-hand side. Moving objects to the bottom or to the front may yield different renders. You can play a bit with the distance from ground to correct some issues, but eventually, you'll probably need to set the right layer order to get the result you want.
Now that we understand the basics of 3D in PowerPoint, let's create the chest bone and the board. If you find this video useful, please push the like button and help me spread the knowledge to more people.
To create a chest bone, I start by creating a sphere using the method I showed earlier. Then I'm adding another 3D shape, starting with a circle and adding some bevels to it. As I mentioned previously, the easiest would be to send it to the back manually. Let's add another shape with the same method. Then add a semi-sphere at the bottom, and our chest bone is ready. Now, to create the tiles, I've created those 2D shapes. Let's add some rotation to them. Add some depth and shadows. Reposition them in space and in the correct layer order. Then, let's add color to them. Let's increase the distance from ground for one of them. Let's add a gradient to the background, and paste the bone inside the slide. Customize the slide to your liking, and of course, you can use the morph transition to animate your 3D shapes. I hope you learned something useful. Thank you for watching, and have a creative day.